only asset in the world that is offsetting the monetary printing. It's not gold. It's Bitcoin. Bitcoin has not only offset the monetary printing, but massively outperformed it. One other asset has, which is the NASDAQ after 2008. But Bitcoin is the one thing that is outperforming the Fed balance sheet. And that means that it is offsetting the debasement of currency. Once I realized that, and that Bitcoin was going to be the supermassive black hole that eats all other asset classes, I just realized there was no point doing anything else.
Raoul Pal is a renowned macro analyst and founder of Global Macro Investor, a macro research that helps investors navigate the murky waters of global macro events and how they impact the financial markets. The firm uses the global macro strategy approach to investments, an approach based on the interpretations and expectations of large macroeconomic events. With two full-on wars, massive global debts and debt expenses, peak levels of polarity among countries, and a rapidly escalating global liquidity crisis, this is definitely an important time to explore the macro before making any big moves in the financial markets. No one knows for certain how events will unfold or what their consequences will be, but one thing that is very obvious, according to Raoul Pal, is the role of Bitcoin, the world's largest crypto asset, in the new era of global economy and finance. Pal believes we are on the cusp of a new dawn, one that will reshape everything from markets and economics to society as we know it, and that Bitcoin will be the foundation stone of what we need to build a new financial system. In addition, the former Goldman Sachs executive believes the global debt spiral makes it compulsory that governments will keep printing money indefinitely, at least until the current financial system collapses and there's a total financial reset. This is another big boon for Bitcoin, which Powell explains is one of the only two assets that have significantly outperformed the Federal Reserve's balance sheet since it started announcing rounds of quantitative easing measures after the global financial crisis in 2008. At least a decade of history tells us that the more cowbell the Fed and other major central banks announce, the more Bitcoin outperforms, not just the Fed's balance sheet, which can be directly linked to currency debasement, but also other asset classes, including stocks, bonds, and real estate. We will now bring you clips from one of Raoul Powell's video broadcasts as he vividly describes the big picture of money printing, piling debts, the inevitable shift toward government-controlled digital currencies, and Bitcoin's role in the new era of global finance. Please ensure you stick around to the end of the video, subscribe to the channel, and don't forget to smash the like button to help with the YouTube algorithm. Thanks and enjoy.
I want to give you the big picture, the really big picture, where I think everything is going, and it's obviously mainly about the digital asset space, because I think it's the single most important thing for everybody to understand. And in order to do that, I'm going to give you my journey of discovery so you can piece together some of what I've learned on my way, because there are many narratives you've heard me speak about, but I haven't really put the whole lot together to give somebody or all of you something really meaty to get your heads around. Now, again, you don't need to agree with all of it, but I want to show you my journey, how I got here, what I think is going on in the macro backdrop, what I think this means and why I chose Bitcoin and then cryptocurrencies, why I diversified, what I think the actual space is really headed, and where this whole thing is going and how it fits in to the future of everything. Let's go back to the beginning. So 2008 was a period, in fact, I'm going to go back to 2000. 2000, we started to see the debt bubble increase and the rise of central banks. So Alan Greenspan back in 87 was the first one to start using interest rates really to stabilize markets. That became modus operandi by 1998 when long-term capital blew up. The Fed did it again under Greenspan. Then 2000, we had the stock market crash and the recession. And again, interest rates were used heavily. Now, the money illusion meant that lower interest rates, people thought, I'm going to take on more debt. So they took on more and more debt. And that led to the housing bubble, as we know. And then that blew up and almost brought down the world's financial system. Now, I was in Spain at the time. I'd left the hedge fund industry, but I was still writing, as I do today, Global Macro Investor. And I realized that the fragility of the system was now becoming the most urgent thing. And that after 2008, we hadn't really solved it. In fact, it was bloody clear by the time we got into the European crisis in 2012 that it was not solved at all. And debt was the big issue. And the only answer at this stage became the printing of money, because there was no other way to deal with it. It had become too big, too gigantic, too scary, too dangerous for anybody to let the fire burn. The whole Austrian economic idea of creative destruction was now almost impossible to implement, because the destruction would have been total and complete. But after 2012, I wanted to make sure that there was a way out. Now, that was the first time I wrote an article. I think it was about 2013, I wrote an article called The Life Raft, where I talked about gold and, in fact, Bitcoin. I had started to have Bitcoin on my radar screen as some good friends of mine, some Global Macro Investor members, had been involved in early days. I was going to set up the world's safest bank. That was the idea. A bank that only held US treasuries, and that any money on deposit was entirely matched by treasuries that were held at the Fed. No rehypothecation, no nothing. So it was kind of a bank outside the banking system. I had that idea, but it's bloody hard to set up a bank. You know, people like Caitlin Long, I'm good on you. It's really hard to do. So I was running around the world looking at this idea, and the Bitcoin idea came to me from Emil Woods. And Emil said to me, listen, this might be your answer. And I had seen it and looked at it, and it was very interesting. 2013, I bought it. It went up 100% in a month, and I sold it. And I was like, wow, okay, what was that? I wrote an article in 2013 or 14 about the stock to flow of Bitcoin, looking at it versus gold, and saying with gold at about $1,300, where it was at the time, I would impute roughly, without the great maths that my friend Planner B has managed to do, but I had a rough rule of thumb that Bitcoin was probably worth $1 million in comparable terms, using stock to flow, you know, how much gold was on the ground, how much gold was being mined, etc., and back imputing into the Bitcoin price. And that gave us a macro framework, and that macro framework became quite well known at the time and got passed around and got people, many people, into the space, actually. Then I was out of the space for a while and got back in around 2015-16. And I started buying again, probably around 200. And I think I sold out early when the forks were happening.
During the broadcast, Powell discusses the convergence between Bitcoin, crypto, and macro, a thought process that has quickly gained popularity even among the biggest fundamentalists in the cryptocurrency industry. Unlike the first set of participants in the cryptocurrency industry, macro experts with previous traditional finance experience like Powell argue that Bitcoin cannot be studied as an entity existing outside macroeconomic conditions. Despite its many impressive qualities and underlying fundamentals, it is still going to be affected by things like inflation, deflation, recession, broad money supply, and other factors that move prices in other asset classes, at least until it matures fully and is more widely adopted and accepted. In the meantime, while it nears full maturity and the world gradually transitions to the next era of global finance, Powell is 100% certain that Bitcoin will keep rising indefinitely and will continue to outperform every other asset class. Here are more clips from the video.
I had always said that crypto and Bitcoin in particular and macro were the same thing. They just didn't know it yet. And most participants didn't know it and didn't understand it. Crypto came from a different community. It came from a community of developers, the kind of cypherpunks. It came from Austrian economic school kind of philosophy. It became from libertarian philosophy. It came from a number of different things, but it started to attract the attention of finance people, particularly the macro guys like myself. You know, our job is to find assets that best represent our views and where we are in the world. And we are all, without question, troubled by the debt supercycle and how this all plays out. So when we saw Bitcoin, you know, one by one, people moved across. Famously, Dan Moorhead was first. And then a lot of people, whether it was John Burbank, Mark Yusko, whether it was Dan Tapiero, whether it was myself, Mike Novogratz, I mean, bit by bit, everybody from the macro world, Stan Druckenmiller, Paul Tudor Jones, Alan Howard, you name it, they're all moving across because they've seen the magnitude of the opportunity, because we all knew that they weren't parallel paths, they were convergent paths. But it's the macro backdrop of that that is very important to understand, because within this, the only answer was the creation of more money. And that creation of more money was clearly going to be very, very beneficial to Bitcoin, because it was basically created for this. And I pointed out early on, back in March and April, that Bitcoin was two things. It was this store of value narrative. And it also had a call option on the future. And I started developing some big meta-narratives to help get people across the line, because I know it's a scary, different world and people don't want to understand this weird digital money. I don't want to throw money at this. But I tried to explain to people in simple terms things like pristine collateral, how this is superior than many things that we have in the existing system, or in fact, all of the things that we have, how it acts differently, how you can't create more of it. So it's collateral, it's worth more, and therefore is a better foundation stone for the financial system of the future. And how, as a store of value, it offsets the monetary printing, and how this could all transition into a future economic system that had incredible value. And that's what made me irresponsibly long. The next part of it that I think was maybe the light bulb moment for many was my new Bretton Woods, the Bitcoin life raft piece. And that essentially was saying that, okay, what also is coming is the central banks have seen this digitization of money and they want to be involved. And they want to be involved by creating central bank digital currency, not as a competitor to Bitcoin, but as an ancillary agent within this new digital money system. And that's all well and good. That's basically government stablecoins. Fine, I get it. It's much better. It works really well. But it also has other qualities, because the other qualities are it's programmable. So essentially, central banks can program money so we all have different monetary policy or different tax regimes or whatever it may be. The point being is behavioral economics is going to shoehorn its way in to monetary and fiscal policy, which are combining. And at that point, we are really beholden to what central banks do. Can they destroy money? Can they destroy our capital, our savings? Of course they can. And we needed a life raft. And Bitcoin was going to be it.
Like every other sound money advocate, Raoul Powell is certain that the world needs a new financial system, one that is based on governments continuously printing their way out of every recession or collapse. If the present system continues with the ever-increasing debt, it is only a matter of time before even the United States becomes another Venezuela, where asset prices are rising rapidly in dollar terms but not actually outperforming the rate of currency debasement. There is no doubt that that is exactly where the world is heading, and Bitcoin was created for that specific purpose. If the past 14 years of its creation tell us anything, it is the fact that Bitcoin will survive anything thrown at it, and it will help you protect and increase your wealth over time. What are your thoughts on Raoul Powell's video? Do you agree that Bitcoin will survive this era and whatever crisis that unfolds and will be the foundation for creating a new era of global finance? Please drop your comments and observations in the comments section below. Also, ensure you like this video, subscribe to the channel, and turn on post notifications for more videos like this. Thanks for watching.